Okay, hey, welcome back. Seventh module of the day on the Faster Data Insight Jumpstart.
I'm excited to be here, Dandy.
Glad to have you. This is probably, if you look at it, one of my most interesting features that I've seen in Power BI. It's the Q&A natural language querying. It's been, in my opinion, it's been mind-blowing on the way we deal with that. And the great thing is that I actually have Adam Wilson here. He's one of the program managers that's been working on this feature, that's been doing a lot of work on this. And I could not find any better PM to actually present this and talk about the Q&A feature, what it is, how it works, what the capabilities are, some of the insights you can give us. So with that, Adam, how about you tell the audience a little bit about yourself and what makes you passionate coming to work every day to do all this Q&A.
Thanks, Andy. So I've been on the Q&A team since it was an early incubation, and I'm really passionate about making data accessible to as many people as possible. I worked on Q&A mostly because I'm interested in finding data and making it accessible to as many people as possible. Before working on Q&A, I was part of a project called the Windows Azure Marketplace, which focused on public domain data and commercial data sources and how we make those available to many different people. And it was through this experience I realized it wasn't just about having the right data, it was about making it easy to discover and explore that. And that was a natural segue for me to start working on Q&A. And I'm so excited that the project has gotten this far and we're ready to start speaking about it with you. If you can jump ahead to the next slide, we can.
Yeah, so if you're looking at where we are, right? We talked about the creation in the Excel workbook, data discovery, data analysis, the visualization aspect, and so on. Now, Q&A sits more in the consumption of that data, but I assume you're going to be talking about the authoring experience and how we can optimize those data models for natural language query, right?
Absolutely. I think you said it right. There are two parts. There's really how Q&A is experienced by an end user, which looks like it's simple and frictionless, but we're also going to take you behind the scenes and show you how you can create great models that work with Q&A.
So when I started playing around with this, and it's probably not the right message to bring to the audience, the only thing I did was I published a workbook, and magically I could start asking questions just with no effort. Then I learned something about the modeling and the modeling capabilities, and that just really opened the world to like, wow, this is really amazing. So how about we dive in there, we switch over to your machine, and you're going to show us all those capabilities that we have aligned for the audience.
Absolutely. Happy to do it.
Thanks.
Okay. Q&A is really all about data exploration. When we started this project, we talked to a lot of customers, and they were trying to make data-driven decisions at every level of their organization, often dozens or hundreds of times a day. And they faced a number of key problems when they did this. One was around, how do I find the right data to answer the question I have at this point in time? There are lots of different data sources, and how do you know which one to look at? A second key problem they faced was around finding the right answer among myriad different pre-built reports. Sometimes they didn't slice the right way, or you didn't have something already built that answered your question. And oftentimes you needed to make a decision right away, but it would take a while to go and build a report for that. So this is why we introduced Q&A. And it's really data exploration that enables anyone in an organization to discover and find answers. And more importantly, it uses natural language. So you don't have to learn new languages or new keywords. You just type as you would to any search engine. You know, anecdotally, when we spoke to some customers, we found one of our early customers. They were a group of product managers. And they would go into these meetings where they would talk about strategy and they would try to plan features for their particular product. But oftentimes, they didn't have the data at hand that needed to make the decision. They had lots of cubes and lots of reports. We gave them Q&A, and within a week, they found 25 product improvements they wanted to make just because it was so much easier to find the answers. And now many of these product managers leave Q&A up on their computer screen throughout the day so they can ask questions as they go. And trust me, the analysts that used to build reports for them also love this feature because now they empowered their end users to find the answers themselves. Okay, enough talking. Let's do a quick demo of this. The demo I'm going to do today is on top of customer data. So this is a typical customer relationship management model where, as my hypothetical company, I have a list of customers. I have a list of opportunities. These are people that my sales team talked to try and convert into real customers. And I also have my salespeople, the employees in my table here. I want to show you an example of how I can take this very simple model that I created with Excel and Power Pivot and enable it for Q&A and get some very basic answers right away without doing any extra work. So I'm going to switch now to my Power BI site. I've already uploaded a first version of this model. It's called the CRM1 model. Again, I didn't do anything specific for Q&A with this. I just created a model in Excel and did basic data modeling using Power Pivot. Once I've uploaded it, I can click the option menu here and choose Add to Q&A. This is really important because Q&A searches the workbooks you specifically added to Q&A. If you have hundreds of different workbooks in your Power BI site, you can choose which ones are searched using Q&A. Also, I can only see the workbooks that I have permissions to access. So if different users have different SharePoint permissions, they're only going to see answers from Q&A based on the workbooks that they have access to. So once I've added this, I can click the Search with Power BI Q&A link at the top of the page, and this takes me into the Q&A data exploration experience. At the top of the page, you'll see something that looks like a search box you might see in a search engine. This is no mistake. We built Q&A to play off of the search metaphor, and we hope people will approach Q&A and use it much as they would a search engine. So I can ask some very simple questions. Well, let's say I want to look at the list of the opportunities my company has. I can just type in opportunities. And here below, I see a table that includes the list of opportunities for my company. You'll notice a few things. Below the question I typed, we see text in blue. This is called the restatement. And this is how the Q&A system understood what I was asking. And below that as well, you'll see three suggestions on how I could extend this question. So I could click those to try asking something new and learn about other kinds of questions I could ask. Let's say I'm interested in just one of my potential customers. They're called the Amazing Sales Store. You'll notice as I type, we get suggestions on how I could complete this. So I actually have two different customers in my database, one called Amazing Sales and one called Amazing Sports Store. So I can click the customer I want, and I'm looking for their opportunities. And this will bring back the opportunities for that customer. So really easy. I can use values from my database, names of tables and columns, and Q&A works on top of all of that. If I wanted to look at another customer, I can actually just click the existing customer here and switch to another one. Well, let's look at the opportunities for active marketing. So here are the active marketing opportunities. Let's go and look at Northwind Traders. So really easy just to click around and see different results right away. Up until this point, we've seen Q&A return answers in the form of tables. In many cases, this gives you the answer you're looking for, but Q&A can do much more. It can perform analysis, and it can bring back graphs and charts and maps, depending upon the kind of question you ask. More importantly, as a user, you don't need to explicitly ask for a particular visual. Q&A has an intelligent system that finds the best visual for the kind of question you ask. So let's look at some of these different kinds of visualizations. So maybe I want to look at the revenue that my company has earned. So let's look at total revenue by customer. And because I asked to compare this for different customers, Q&A decided that the best visual was a bar chart. So I can see all of my different customers compared, and the Sales Dealers Association is at the top here. I can ask something a little bit more complicated. Maybe I want to compare the revenue I get from customers and the size of those customers, well, how many employees they have working for them. So I can ask about total revenue and number of employees by customer. And so here we can see a scatter plot's brought back. So I sell mostly to retail companies, so a lot of them have a small number of employees. We have some over here that are more distributors, so they have fewer employees but a lot of revenue I'm getting from them. And then we have these up here in the top left. They have a lot of employees but I'm not getting much revenue. Maybe I should go and see if I can cross-sell new products to them. So I can ask other kinds of questions too. Maybe I want to see a geographic distribution of my sales. Let's look at the total revenue by country. And here, because I asked for it by country, Q&A knows to return it as a map. And so I can see that the US is clearly the largest the largest country I sell to. Maybe I want to see how my sales force maps to this, which of my salespeople work for these different customers. So let's look at it by country and the owner of these different accounts. And we can see I've done a pretty good job. I've distributed my salespeople to different locations. So Mark works in Europe mostly. In North America, we have Terry Adams. But there's a bit of an aberration here. There's one customer that is not associated with Terry. Let's drill down on that. So I can just ask a different question here. Let's look at USA customers and their owners. And sure enough, we see Terry Adams has most of them. But if I scroll down, Mark Harrington actually has one of the USA customers. This is probably a good example where I should go talk to Mark and see if it might make sense to get Terry to work on this. So there are lots of opportunities to go back and forth, drill down and drill out. And with Q&A, I can navigate easily back to earlier questions I asked. So let's go back and look at total revenue by country again. You know, in this case, I can see that the USA is the top country I sell to, but what's second? It's kind of hard to tell from this graph. Sometimes Q&A returns a visualization that may not be the best for the particular analysis I want to do. So there are ways that we can override that. The easiest way is just by asking for it. So if I want to see this as a bar chart, I can just type that in the question box, and Q&A brings me back the result. So here I can see very clearly that Vietnam is second, followed closely by Chile. Now, if users don't necessarily know to type that in the question box, they can also just click. So they can choose a table, or they can go back and look at it as a map. So it's very easy to switch back and forth to different visuals depending upon the particular analysis you're looking for. Okay, so that was a sneak peek at the visualization capabilities provided by Q&A. Q&A also understands what you're asking for, beyond just keywords in your question. It can do things such as filtering. Let's say I want to look at my biggest customers. So let's look at customers with total revenue over 500,000. You can see as I type this, it filters down and shows me the customers that match that. So we support lots of different kinds of numeric filters on your database. But we also have time intelligence functions, because we know in many cases you want to look at things over time and for specific time periods. So let's look at customers and their opportunities in 2013. So here in this case, if we look at the restatement, we're showing the opportunities and their actual close date, where that close date is in 2013. So Q&A knew that because I asked for a date, that I should filter based on the actual close date. So I can filter for years, I can ask for February 2013, and it just brings back those. I can do date ranges, I can say between June and September 2013 or 2012. I can even ask for relative dates. I could say in the last year. And Q&A will bring me back all of the opportunities that were closed in the last year. So there are lots of different ways that you can filter based on numeric and string and dates just by typing the question. Again, you don't have to do it just through the question. We also have the familiar filter pane from PowerView here. So I can expand the filter pane and I could change any of these filters. So if I didn't want it to be January, I could go and filter this to start in March 2013 and apply that filter, and instantly I can see that it's filtered down on the right-hand side. Maybe I should do February in this case. Great. In addition to the filter pane, we also have the field list. So if I wanted to see the owner in addition to just these attributes, I could come in here and just drag owner on here, and very easily I can see which salesperson owns that. So lots of ways to interact with it beyond just using the question box. And one of the reasons we did this is because we wanted Q&A to be as accessible to as many users as possible, regardless of their familiarity. We know that when users familiar with PowerView use Q&A, they like the familiarity of the field list and the filter pane. But for many users that might be intimidated by that or don't have experience yet, the natural language is a very easy way to start asking questions without learning a lot of complicated metaphors. So let's look at some other examples of what we can ask. let's ask who owns one of my particular customers, bold, sales, accessories. Now, in this case, I'm asking for the salesperson that owns this particular customer. I didn't ask for salesperson. All I said was who owns. So in this case, Q&A knew that there was a relationship between salespeople and customers, and that when I say who owns something, I want to see the salesperson. This is an example of a relationship that we automatically determine. It just happens that I have an owner column on the opportunity, and because I have an owner column, we let you ask questions about who owns it and what the owner is just by virtue of using a column called that. So let's go back and ask a few other interesting questions. Let's say, let's go back and look at the revenue. So here's an example where I just have looked at overall view of my business, and it looks like I did pretty well between 2009 and 2012. I had a growth rate of well in excess of 50% over those 4 years. But you know, maybe I want to compare that against my industry. Well, let's look at total revenue by year for software companies. Okay, so here we have some software companies, and sure enough, they have growth, but in terms of, you know, relative percentages, it's actually not as much. But the interesting thing here is that you'll notice on the left-hand side, this data is not coming from my CRM model. Here's my CRM model here. It's actually coming from another Excel workbook I have that has public financial information. I didn't have to do anything different in Q&A. I asked a question, and Q&A automatically selected the workbook that it thought could answer the question best. The way it does this is by running that question through all of the workbooks I've added to Q&A from my Power BI site, and it automatically scores and chooses the workbook with the best interpretation for my question, and that's what it shows to me. Now, if I didn't want to see the answer from public company financials, and I really wanted to see it from CRM, I can always just select that. And so in this case, it'll give me the interpretation from this model. And you'll notice at the top, it's grayed out software companies. Because in my CRM model, it doesn't know what software companies means. And it's just showing me my revenue over this period. If I always want to get answers from a particular workbook, I can use the pin feature here. And once I pin this workbook, the answers are always going to come from that particular model, which is really nice if you're doing a set of different explorations and you want to make sure it comes from a particular data source. So we've seen lots of different examples of questions that work on a workbook that I created with Power Pivot. Didn't do anything special for Q&A. But there's some questions that just aren't going to perform unless you do modeling specific for the Q&A experience. For example, at the very beginning, we asked for a list of opportunities, which brought back the opportunities for my company. But maybe inside my company, people refer to opportunities sometimes as leads. So someone might type in leads. But in this case, we just don't have a good answer. And that's because the name of the table in the Excel workbook is called opportunities. Leads doesn't appear anywhere in my workbook, and so Q&A doesn't know how to perform the search for it and return the right answer. We'll show you how a little bit later you can use a new feature in Power Pivot called synonyms to teach Q&A to give the right answer in this case. So this was a good look at the kinds of questions you can ask. Now we want to switch gears and show the kinds of things you can do to build great models for Q&A. The first thing I want to say is that there's good news. If you're already building workbooks for Power View, you're doing the things you need to do for Q&A already. I'll show you some specific examples, but the formatting and the categorization you do in Power Pivot that benefits Power View is also used by Q&A. So you have a head start if you've already done that. Let me switch to the Excel experience here. So here's the same CRM model I showed you. I just want to show you a few examples of what you can do to give great visualizations in Q&A. I'm first going to go to my opportunities table here. You'll notice we asked a lot of questions about actual close date, and I never had to use the actual closed date name in any of my questions. The reason for this is because Q&A uses the data types you set in Power Pivot to infer how you'll use those columns in questions. So because I set actual close date as a date column, that allows me to ask something like opportunities in 2013. So setting the data type is really important, especially for dates, but also for numerics or other filtering capabilities work in those cases. If I switch to the customers table, let me show you the default field set. In this case, I've chosen a set of fields for the default field set. This is used in Power View if you drag that table entity over, and it'll choose these by default. It's also used by Q&A if you just ask for the name of that table. So if I said show customers, Q&A is going to use your default field set to determine which columns are shown to the users. So this is a great way to choose what summary information gets shown in Q&A. In addition to the default fields, another important characteristic is the default label. So you might remember I asked total revenue by customer. Q&A used the default label to determine which column from the customer table to show on the axis. So when it showed the bar chart of customers by revenue, it actually showed the customer name rather than another one of these properties. So that's another important thing to do. Finally, a lot of the visualizations we do in Q&A are based on not only the data type, but additional semantic information about your data. So let's go and take a look at the country column here. You'll remember that we asked a question about total revenue by country. Now, country is just a string column, but we knew that we should show it on a map. That's because the data category was set to country region. And you'll notice it says suggested here. Power Pivot will automatically try to detect what the data category is for your columns based on the values that are in it and the names of the columns. But if it's not right, you can always go and select the right one here. So together, all of these factors, the data type, the default field set, the data category, and the information on relationships is used by Q&A to provide great visualizations and also to interpret the question you're asking. But this still isn't going to help to solve the problem of how you get the right answer for leads, because it doesn't appear anywhere in your database, and it's not really a semantic property. So next, I'd like to show you something called synonyms. Synonyms are just alternative words you can attach to tables and columns in your workbook, and then when you search for those using Q&A, it will map back to the table or column that that refers to. We've added this through a new ribbon button in Power Pivot called Synonyms. When you click this ribbon button, we take you into the diagram view, and we expand a new pane on the right-hand side that shows you the list of the synonyms. Each of these sections in this pane corresponds to either the table itself, so in this case, the first one is the customer's table, and below it are all of the columns and measures. So if I go to the bottom, you'll see that we have the total revenue measure. So for each of these tables, columns, or measures, I can add a comma-separated list of additional words that can be used to refer to that. You'll notice that the first word is black. This is what we call the primary noun for this particular entity. And this is what Q&A uses in the restatement. So if there's one word that you think most people in your organization will use to refer to something, it's best to put that first, so it's the primary noun, and it'll be shown back to them. So you'll notice on the opportunities table over here, I've added lead as one of those synonyms. In some cases, we will automatically generate synonyms. For example, if you have a column that is using camel case, so uppercase actual, uppercase close, uppercase date without any spaces, we'll split that for you. So we'll do some things automatically, but these values which make sense in your particular business, you're going to have to go and add. But we found that it's really easy to just incrementally go through and add a few of them as we go. So you'll notice that this workbook is called CRM 2. This is a second version that has all of these synonyms added. I've already added this to my Power BI site over here. And now if I switch from the CRM 1 workbook to try and get an answer from the CRM 2 workbook, you'll notice that leads now returns an answer. The restatement here says show opportunity, and so that's because opportunity was the primary noun there. And we bring back the same table of opportunities as we did at the very beginning of the demo. And this is very robust. You don't just have to use the word leads. I can ask any of the questions I showed earlier in the demo, but now, instead of using opportunities, I can use the word leads. So let's do an example here. Let's type in number of leads by country. So as before, now we're bringing back the leads as a bubble on each of the countries. Synonyms are a really robust way to increase the percentage of questions that can be answered using Q&A. We find that once you start deploying workbooks, you'll have users that ask about certain ways to get particular results, and synonyms are often a case where you can go and add that. Okay, once you've built a great model with Q&A, we wanted to build some features in there that let you easily share it with others. And I want to give you a few examples of the different ways you can share answers you're looking for. The first one is simply copying a link. Whenever you've asked a question in Q&A, the link in your address bar will take you back to that question you've asked before. So if I copy this link and open a new tab, I can go ahead and paste that in there, and I'm going to come back and see the exact same question I asked before. So this is really good if you want to send an email to a colleague. You could even create a dashboard with a bunch of links to specific Q&A questions. You can have IM sessions and send those off to other people. We've even had teams of reporting analysts that normally field emails from reporting users that now use Q&A as a way of giving back an answer to an end customer. So not only do they get the answer they're looking for, but now they get a starting point where they can tweak that and see different kinds of questions. So that's sharing a link. We also have a way that you can create a starting point for Q&A so that a user that comes in for the first time doesn't just stare at an empty question box. Instead, they have some questions that they can begin to ask right away and then iterate on those as they become more familiar with it. So first of all, let's find a question I want to share. Let's do total revenue by customer and product. Okay, so here we can see my customers and which products I'm selling to them. So I can actually copy this question I asked here. And if I click on the Q&A logo, we come to what's called the collage. Right now it's empty because I haven't added any collage questions to it. If I click the plus icon, I get the feature question dialog. And so I can type in a question that I want this tile to refer to. So in this case, I'll use that question I used before. And Q&A tells me that, yes, it was able to find an answer, so you know you didn't make a typo here. And I can do a number of things just to make it visually appealing, because ultimately you want a collage that's going to look really good. So I can change it from a large or a small tile. I can change the background color. You know, maybe I'll make this a bar chart, because that's what it's related to. And when I save it, that's going to appear on my collage so that when someone comes into Q&A for the next time, they're going to see this collage tile. So for example, now if I come back to the Power BI site and I click search with Power BI Q&A, it's going to load that collage tile. So now someone can click that and it'll take them right into that exact question. So let's add one more collage tile here. Let's do a little bit more complicated question. Let's do number of employees and total revenue by customer and owner. So this is showing which of my salespeople focus on which kinds of customers. And you know, maybe we have a goal to kind of align this, and clearly it's not very aligned right now, so we have some work to do. So I want this to appear on my dashboard so that people have it in their minds as they go on there and do their work. So I'm going to copy this question again. I'll go back to my collage here. And I'll add another tile. This time, this is a really important question. So I'm going to show this on the Power BI site homepage. This is more than just a collage. It'll show in another place, which I'll show you. This is also important, so I'll make it a large tile. And maybe also, instead of using a stock background icon, I'm actually going to use an image. So let's just go to Bing, and I'm going to, I sell Microsoft products, so I'm going to do Microsoft Office logo. And let's find something on the Microsoft site here. Okay, so here's an example of a logo here. Let's take that, and I'm just going to copy this logo, and I'm just going to paste that URL right in here. So I can see a preview right away of the tile, and so I have a nice logo with an image I customized, and I'll go ahead and save it.
So one of the great things there is, as you're putting in that favorite question, like you could actually just use Windows Azure Storage, upload your own images there, easily expose that as HTTP, right?
Yep.
If you just make that a public source.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's one of the strengths where really we tie the framework together, right? You have your Azure Storage. It takes me literally a second to make that all HTTP accessible, and
yep.
I can now upload my own images.
Absolutely. Yep. I mean, we thought this was such an important part of the experience,
yep.
being able to create this entry point for your end users, that we wanted to make it as simple as possible to both use stock images
yep.
and to include your own
uh-huh.
images.
Definitely.
Yep. Yeah. So not only do I have the tile here, but now if I go back to my Power BI site, we'll see that I could have featured reports, but also below that, we have a featured question. And so this allows me to promote some of these question tiles right to the very beginning of the experience alongside my pre-built reports. And so now it's very discoverable for end users. They can click this, they come right into Q&A, and they have an answer to a question that that means something to them. The other important thing about featured questions is they can also help someone as they're getting to know the Q&A experience. On the right-hand side, we have what we call a contextual help pane. And if you expand that, it gives you a list of all of the featured questions that are defined for workbooks that have been added to Q&A for this site. So I could go and just click through these different questions and see the different answers. So for someone that just wants to get a sense of what's possible, having a list of featured questions here makes it really easy for them to go through and get a sense of what the model is capable of answering. So those are a few examples of how you can share information using Q&A. Sending links directly to people, you can integrate those into your own sites, but also you can build a dashboard right inside of Q&A with those featured tiles that lead users to answers for questions that have great answers. So the last thing I want to do is talk a little bit about what Q&A does behind the scenes to return great answers, just to reinforce the parts of modeling that are important. So let me switch back to my SharePoint site here. And I'm going to open up how it works. Let me just open this in PowerPoint. One second here. Great. There are really three phases to how Q&A. There are really three phases to how Q&A chooses the right answer for a question. The first is about searching for the right interpretation of that question. This is really looking across all of the different workbooks you've added to a site for Q&A and choosing which one, finding all the ones that could answer that question. The second phase is about scoring. So this is looking at all of those different questions that were asked and workbooks could answer them and finding the best one. And then the third phase there is really about choosing the right visual. So once we have the best answer, how do you find the visual that can really provide the best way to explain that particular answer? So what I want to show you now is a hypothetical example of how this works, so you get a sense of what's involved. So let's imagine we had two workbooks in our Power BI site. You might have one workbook with Olympic information. Maybe you have medals and medal counts and all those sorts of things. And then we had a sales workbook, maybe something like our CRM example that we showed before. So if we took an example question that someone asked, medal count by country for 2012, there might be three different interpretations of that. Maybe in Olympics there were two. So the first one is, well, show me the medal counts and the country that those medalists were from. So the in this case, you know, it would show Canada and the U.S. because that's where those athletes were from. And then it'll filter it down to the year where the Olympics were had, and that was 2012. Well, there might be another example from the Olympics. And this other interpretation is because there's actually ambiguity in this workbook. Country appears in two different places. It first appears in terms of where the athletes are from. That's medal country. But country also appears in terms of where the Olympics were held. So in 2012, they were held in London. So the Olympics host country for 2012 is London. So there's a second interpretation here, which says, okay, show me the medal count and the host country where those Olympics were held, and then filter for only the 2012 year. Similarly, if you went to the sales workbook, you would see the same example. Well, you'd select the country, maybe there's only one country in sales, and in this case, you found 2012 against the order table. So it's going to bring back only the orders in 2012. In the example of the third case here, it didn't actually match medal count at all, so this model just didn't use those particular words. So the first step is really about finding all these different interpretations. Then Q&A does scoring on these. And Q&A uses a number of different factors to score the different interpretations. There are two main ones that I'll talk about. Not that you really have to worry about them in particular, but just so you get a sense of how it works. One of them is based on the coverage of the question you asked. And the premise here is that if we can interpret as many of the words as possible in that question, it's likely we have a good interpretation. So if I only understood one word in your question, for a particular interpretation, that's probably not good, as compared to an interpretation that understood all of the words. The second factor involved in scoring is what we call semantic distance. If you have a really complicated model, and if we can find an answer that uses one small part of your model, we think that's better than one where we have to traverse all sorts of different relationships to get that answer. So if we can use a more compact representation, that tends to be the better interpretation from the examples we've seen. So we can use these two factors to come up with scores for these particular interpretations. So in this case, the first one might be really high because we used every word in that question. And also, the semantic distance was really close. We used the country from the medal table, and we were already using the medal table to get the medal count. The second interpretation from Olympics scores a little bit lower, because instead of using the country from medal, we had to go to another table. That's the Olympics table to get that answer. Sales scored really poorly, mostly because we didn't use all of the words in the question. We didn't understand medal count in this case. So Q&A will now look at all of those scored interpretations, and it's going to choose the best. So in this case, it'll eliminate the bottom two, and what we'll show you is the interpretation, the first one from Olympics. Now, you saw before how you can explicitly change the workbook that you go against. So if I switched in the dropdown from Olympics to sales, we'd actually see the result from the third interpretation. But if the user does nothing, they're going to get the highest scoring one here by default. The final phase is selecting the best visualization. And so in this case, we run through a set of visualization rules to determine how to best visualize that. They look something like this. They say, okay, if the interpretation we selected was showing one measure and one member that was geographic, then we're going to show it in a map. Okay, in this case, I am showing a measure here, and I'm showing a member, and this is geographic, so I could show that in a map. But there are other potential interpretations as well. If I was showing two measures and one member, that would show it as a scatter. You know, and we would go through those different interpretations until we find the one that answers it best. And the way you can influence this is really clear. How these get categorized in Power Pivot affects the visualization we choose. So let's switch to another view on this, how you can influence the best answer. So we had three different phases, and now we have the different ways you can control those phases of the pipeline. So searching for the best interpretations is really about doing the right data modeling. We talked about semantic distance, the relationships you have in your model. That's really important to find the right ones. Synonyms are really important because if we don't understand certain words, we're not going to match those and we won't find those interpretations. In terms of scoring, right, a big influencer here is the workbooks you have in your site. If you have lots of different workbooks in your site, you know, we're going to have to find the best among many different possible cases. But if you find the right workbooks for a particular site in a particular context, it'll be easier for us to score those better. And finally, for selecting the best visualization, there are specific categories of data modeling you can do, specifically around the data types, the data categories, and the default field sets that will help us choose the right visualizations in terms of our visualization rules pipeline and in terms of knowing what fields to return. So this was a lot to digest. I don't expect that you took notes on every single thing I said. So what I'd encourage you to do is go to our blog. We have a blog here on MSDN that describes in concrete terms data modeling tips. So you can go through, look at the things you can do for your model so that they'll work great for Q&A. And again, as I mentioned before, if you've already built Power Pivot models and optimized them for Power View, you'll find that you've actually done a lot of these. So I know we covered a lot today. We looked at the different ways that you could ask questions using Q&A, our different capabilities in terms of visualization, for different filtering, and for synonyms. We showed the modeling behind this, how you can create data models that are optimized for Q&A and specifically to use the synonyms capability of that. And then we went a little bit behind the scenes in terms of how the scoring works, so that you can use that theory when you do your data modeling to come up with great models for Q&A. So we hope that Q&A in your organization becomes a wonderful tool for data exploration and enables as many people as possible to find insights and come up with great answers. Dandy?
Wow. I mean, I'm sitting here and I go like, I'm going to have the opportunity to interfere with Adam and ask him some questions. And it's like, wow, you just went through this and laid it all out there on how Q&A works, the capabilities. We see actually very little questions coming up on the forum, so I think you did an amazing job there on how to get things going. There's one thing that I do want to point out, though, and I was wondering if we could switch to my screen. Okay, so we showed that kind of earlier as we went through the visualization within the demo that Ari did in terms of Power Map, right? And,
okay.
And so what I see a lot is every time we go into Power Pivot, I see the diagrams and I see the relationships and so on. So basically going back to what we've done with that New York City complaint report, right? Pulling in those calls, it actually could be as simple as just pulling in that call data, which we did with Power Query, and we did some calculations to split out the month, the number, the year. And so if we then go into the advanced options here, and we'll look at the synonyms here, you'll see that I have very little tables there, very little work that needs to be done in order to add synonyms to this, right? So what I've actually done with this, and I think just to real quick, as we have about a minute and a half left on this session, is kind of showing how easy it was to actually grab this, add some synonyms to it, so the audience could actually go play with that themselves, some of the data sets that might be interested for them to play with. So looking at this, I actually uploaded that New York City workbook. What I can do is I can add that as a favorite report, and I can add that to Q&A as you showed as well, right? Then going to Q&A there, I can actually now start typing questions in relationship to the city of New York. So I can do things like, hey, show me the number of calls by borrow, okay? Which again takes that visualization into, hey, as you mentioned, it's going to map that out. Should be mapping that out. Okay, let me put that as a bar chart here. Okay, so I can see like, hey, my call volume, city of New York, much more calls from Brooklyn than what I do get from Queens and so on. Drill down into the capabilities like, hey, I want to see that by hour. Okay,
that's so cool.
I mean, look, it just was stunning to me on how easy it is to actually get started with this, and I want to make sure that we land those points very well in terms of being able to bring it as visualizations and so on. I mean, the thing is, I spend a lot of time with Q&A lately, and you've seen that I'm using this in any opportunity that I have. So you see that coming back into some of the status reports that we did at events and so on. And this is just really opening up a great opportunity for everyone to go out there and start asking questions about their data, and fairly simple to get to. So with that, I mean, you've done an amazing job. Thanks for being here with us today. It's I know you're a hard catch. Definitely one of the things we're going to be focusing on as we're leading into some of the other events is focus on the BI Power Hour sessions that we've done so far at the events as well. But yeah, I mean, thanks, Adam.
Happy to be here. It's a fun project. It's great to demo. We love doing it.
And so what's coming up next now is we basically today we went through the entire Power BI stack. A couple of things that we haven't focused on yet is how we work with on-premises data sets. So data sets that resides within your organization that you're now going to be consuming with Power BI. So in the next session, which we're going to start in a little over 10 minutes, I would say, we're going to have Majdi coming out to talk about data management gateway, and then we'll tying together the entire story on how this works. So with that, we'll see you back in 10 minutes. Thank you.